All right, so hello everybody, good evening, welcome to lecture 13 of quantum computation. So in our previous class, we looked at a Jupyter notebook where we examined the protocol for super dense coding. Now, unfortunately, that notebook was not saved, so I wasn't able to share it with you, but I won't make that mistake with the one we're going to work on today. Okay. All right. So again, as usual, I mean, I hope that you all have experimented with this with Jupyter, whether you have your own machine or whether you are using a machine in the computer lab. And also, even if you don't have a laptop, well, or a desktop, you can still build, I mean, even if you have a, tablet, let's say, or you have a mobile phone, a smartphone, you can still build quantum circuits and study them. Because you don't, you know, you don't need to necessarily need. So there are all these wonderful utilities on the that people have designed. So this is one page. This is one example of such a utility. And it goes by the name of Quirk, Q-U-I-R-K. And this has been developed, I believe it has been developed by Thomas Wong, I'm not mistaken. But it's a beautiful website. You can see that you have your circuits, you have your wires, and then you have almost every possible quantum operation that one can imagine. Right? So for instance, if I want to put a Hadamard gate, right, I just click on this Hadamard symbol and drag it to the first circuit, right? And the great thing about this this website is that so it has these different ways of visualizing the results of each the quantum state of each wire. Okay, so if I remove this Hadamard gate, right now my input state is 0, 0. So one can also change the input state here by clicking on this. So if I click on this, it becomes 1. So these two, the first two boxes, they display the chance of being on if measured. Okay, so one second, sorry about that. So this is the probability that your wire is in the up state. Now the first wire starts off in the up is the zero, right? So the first wire starts off in the zero state, so it's off, right? So this whole thing is turned off right now. The second wire starts off in the one state, right? So that's on, 100% on. So this shows 100%. But if you click on this, you can cycle through other states. So if I clicked on this, I get the plus sign here. Right. Let me try to increase this magnification a bit. I click on this, I get the plus sign. So what is the plus state? That's 0 plus 1. And what is the probability of finding that to be on? It's 50%, right? So you can see that this box has filled up to halfway level, right? Then you have another representation of the states, which is the block sphere. On the block sphere, if you remember, the North Pole represents the zero, South Pole represents the one, and points on the equator correspond to equal probability distributions of zero and one. So if you look at the plus state, it corresponds to a point on the positive x-axis. If you look on the negative state, it corresponds to the point on the negative x-axis. And then there is a third kind of superposition, which is 0 plus I1 and 0 minus I1. So there the phase of your relative phase is 90 degrees. There your relative phase between the two states between 0 and 1 is 90 degrees, right? Because e to the I pi by 2, right? Pi by 2 is the phase. E to the pi by 2 is equal to plus minus I pi by 2 is equal to plus minus I. So when you have the I state, you get the point on the positive y axis, and then the minus I state will give you point on the negative y. Click on this back again, you come back to zero. Okay. So these are two representations. Then you have a third one. Okay. This third one, and again, if I mouse over the boxes, it tells me what that box represents. So this box represents the amplitude of 1, 1. Okay. So remember that this is a two qubit system, right? This is a two qubit system. The states of this system can be written in this in terms of 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1, right? Now, in this case, I start out with 0, 0. I don't do anything, right? So all of the three other components should be 0. So this is 1, 0, right? Here the amplitude is 0. You can see that, right? Amplitude is 0, amplitude is 0. Only the 0, 0 state amplitude value is 1, magnitude is 100. And there is also a phase, because you have to remember that there can also be a relative phase, right? So this shows you both the magnitude and the phase. So as an example, if I change this state, if I change it to 0, 1, right, what will happen? This 0, 0 amplitude goes to 0. And this is the 1, 0 amplitude. So in the convention of Quirk, the first qubit is at the bottom, right? So you count from the bottom up. So then if I click on this, I should get 1, 1, right? And then if I go to some a state which is of the form plus, right? So if you work it out, you should get, what is the total state of the system? It's plus, because this is the first qubit, the lower one, plus tensor one. What is plus? Plus is 0 plus 1, right? So 0 plus 1 tensor 1 will give you 0, 1 plus 1, 1. Right? So this is 0, 1 amplitude is 1 by root 2. And this is 1 by 1, 1, which has 1 by root 2. Okay? So let me just reset. Okay. Now, for instance, if I want to create a bell pair, right? How do I create a bell pair? First, I act on one of my qubits with a Hadamard. So if I put a Hadamard, what does it do? It takes my zero state and converts it to 0 plus 1, right? So here, these two both get an amplitude of 1 by root 2, right? This is the 0, 0 state, and this is the 0, 1 state, right? So the first qubit is not being affected. The second qubit becomes an equal superposition of 0 and 1. Okay. Now we apply a C naught, right? We apply a C naught. So this is the control qubit, and this is our target qubit. Okay. And now, what does our state look like? Right. Amplitude of 0, 0 is 1/√2. Amplitude of 1, 1 is 1/√2. Right. 0.707. You can see 0.707. That is 1/√2. So we get the entangled Bell state. Right. And then we also have in this in these gates, we have measurement also, right? So this is a measurement gate. Okay, so I can put this here, for instance, and this is a measurement gate. Now with these gates, what I can do is I can build my for instance, my circuit for quantum teleportation. Okay, so I'll have to refer to my notes to just remind myself what that circuit looks like. Right. So we will need one more qubit, we'll need a third qubit. And for that, we'll add it. It'll get added in a second. Okay. So first, let me remove these. So I'll draw the circuit for quantum teleportation, and then we'll see how it works. So the circuit starts out as follows. You have Alice and Bob. This wire here, the middle wire, represents Alice. There will be a third wire which will represent Bob's qubit. Bob is not in the picture yet. Okay. Well, actually, Bob should be in the picture. So what we'll do is, okay, so this is Bob. Now, what happens? To begin with, what do? We act with a Hadamard gate, right? And act with a C naught. What does this do? This puts these two qubits, Alice and Bob's qubits, into an entangled state. It becomes a Bell pair, right? So if you look at the non-zero components, you see 0, 0, 0 and 1, 1, 0. So remember, this is the first qubit, this is the second qubit, this is the third qubit. So when it says 1, 1, 0, that means you should read it as 1, 1, and then 0, right? So the third qubit is in the 0 state, and the first two qubits are in the entangled Bell state, which is how we start off with the teleportation protocol, right? And this is our unknown state, okay? I mean, this can be anything. So let's just make it 1. We can make it anything we like. We'll play around with different values. We want to transport this state from Alice to Bob, right? So what does Alice do? The first thing she does is that she performs a C naught, which will entangle her state, her qubit, with the unknown state, right? And I'm looking, is there a barrier? I don't see that. Okay, never mind. So we put a control over here and a C naught. Now, what happens is that Alice's qubit becomes entangled with the unknown state, whatever the unknown state. Okay. And then we apply a Hadamard So now, okay, so what are the steps? Let me again remind myself. So right. So then, and then Alice applies a Hadamard gate to this third, to the unknown state. And at this point, right, what she does is she takes this qubit, puts it in a box, and sends it to Bob. Okay. Then Bob ends up with this qubit, Alice's qubit, and his own qubit, right? And he starts to make measurements. So he makes a measurement on the unknown state and on Alice's qubit. Okay. And what he does is if this measurement result, for instance, gives him a certain output, he acts on his own qubit, right? He acts on his own qubit with a z state here. So with Quirk, I'm not 100 can't control. Okay. No. Conditional measurement. Okay, so you know what? Let me go to the menu and let me just look at the teleportation circuit. Okay, so they have already made it out for us, right? This is the teleportation circuit. And this is the control. And okay. Oh, no. I was doing the right thing. Clear circuit. So let me just do it again. So we put a Hadamard and C naught. We make the bell pair. Then we entangle Alice's qubit. With the unknown one, we apply a Hadamard to the unknown one. Then we perform a measurement on the first state and on the second state. And then we put a control here, right? And this gives us control Z. And I think that this should actually come afterwards. And then we put another control here. And we put the X gate, right? So this is the X gate. Now, the end result of this should be that Bob's qubit, right? Both of these qubits have been measured. The end result should be that Bob's qubit ends up in the same state as this unknown state that we started out with, right? So let's just put some value for this unknown state, right? Let's say it's 1. And now we will measure Bob's qubit. Okay. So what is the result of measuring Bob's qubit? So Bob's qubit is the first qubit. And let's see. Okay, so let me work. Right. So they obviously, this is a much better circuit than the one I have drawn. The reason is the following, right? So in order to show that the state that is sent by Alice is the same as the state that is being received by Bob, what they have done is they have put a time dependent state over here. Okay, and so you can put a time dependent state by using one of these gates. Okay, so you have ZT for instance, or YT or XT. You put any of those, what it does is it creates a cyclic state. And then here, they have put a block state. Okay, so I have to put a block sphere. Where is the block sphere? Block. Right? So we'll start with block over here. Right? So this is in the one state. Now let me put a block over here. Okay, and I don't need this. And this should give me, the reason is that this should be here, right? Now you see that this block sphere and this block sphere, they're showing the same state. So that means I have succeeded in teleportation. Let me try changing the value of this state, right? I change it to plus. You see that the block sphere here and the block sphere here becomes the same. Change it to minus, right? So the block sphere remains the same. If I make this some time dependent state, for instance, okay? So I put some time dependent gate here. Now what happens? It creates a time dependent rotation around the Z axis. And by looking at the fact that both of these block spheres are synchronized, you can see that the state is being teleported. Okay? So you don't need to even have a laptop or desktop. This is something that you can load on your mobile phone, though, I mean, on your mobile phone, I'm not sure how clear things would be. But the point is that, well, you know, you can do something. All right. Then the second thing is that the IBM QIS kit website also has a similar circuit design web page. Okay. That's called the Composer, IBM Composer. Okay. So, well, you don't need to sign in. It's good to sign in only if you need to sign in only if you want to run it on the right. And then there are, well, all sorts of guide tutorials, etc., that you can follow. And you can see that this has a very similar structure to the Quirk setup, right? You have a Hadamard gate. You have these control C0s, right? And maybe you have a slightly better representation of what's going on than in the Quirk case. It's a little bit clearer. And here you see the probabilities for the different basis states. So when we are dealing with three qubits here, we get 8 basis states. And so this tells you what is the respective probability. And this shows the representation on the block sphere. But this representation is actually not the block sphere representation, it's something called the Q sphere representation. Which is, something that these IBM people have come up. And I have to properly understand it myself. Right? But anyway, so you can play around with this, right? And so these are two tools, okay? Now let's go back to what I originally wanted to talk about, which is circuit identities. All right, so we are back with our Jupyter notebook now. Right, so I put my custom macros that I told you about earlier. Then we import our we import our libraries numpy, QISKit, and then we import this visualization library. Okay, so QISKit has a wonderful visualization library, QISKit.visualization. We import it as QVIS. Okay, and then what we want to look at is a phenomenon which is known as phase kickback. Okay, all right. So what exactly is this phase kickback? Well, let us start with our ordinary quantum circuit, right? For a 2-qubit state, we create our circuit, right? And we create our bell pair, right? So this will create our bell pair, right? Hadamard followed with a C naught. Okay, now what do you do if you want to look at the result of the output of this circuit? Okay, so first let's see how to do that. So these are the following steps. You have to select a backend. Okay, so you can use this air module. So you say air.getBackend, and then you say air simulator. Now, if you want, you can type this command air.backends to get a complete list of all the allowed backends. Okay, so these are all the different possible methods of simulating the quantum circuit. They are inequivalent methods. So in practice, when you're building a quantum circuit and you're simulating it, you should run it through various different simulators and make sure that you get the same answer. Otherwise, there's a possibility that there is something wrong in your code. Okay. So we use this simulator backend. Okay. Then we have this command save state vector, right? And then, so what this command does is, well, what it says, right? That the result of this computation is saved. Then this assembles it into a big unitary gate. And now let's go step by step. First, let's run this simulation. So we'll run this compiled object, assembled object, okay? And then when you run this, then you take the result of this run, okay? Result. Okay. And now what you can do is you can take this result object, and it has a method called get state vector. Okay, so I say out state is equal to circ result dot get state vector. Now what is this out state? If I just type this, right, it tells me what this object is. It's a state vector. But QISKit has a very beautiful set of utilities. One of these utilities is the following. So it's an element of this QISKit.visualization module, which I've imported as QVIS. And it's the following. QVIS.array to LaTeX. Okay. What is LaTeX? LaTeX, I've shown you all what it is, right? Zero, you can, write things in mathematics and have them be written in the Jupyter notebook. So you say QVIS array to LaTeX on this out state. Okay. And it gives us this nice array. What does this tell us? This tells us that the first vector, first component has amplitude 1/√2, the last component has amplitude 1/√2, right? What does that correspond to? That's the bell state, beta 0, 0, right? Which corresponds to 0, 0 plus 1, 1. Okay. Now you can also have, you also have this block sphere visualization in QIS kit. Okay. So let's do that. Let's say QVIS dot plot block multi-vector. Okay. Why multi-vector? So that there are different versions of this. There is a block vector. There's plot multi-vector. Multi-vector is when you are dealing with more than one qubit, right? Block multi-vector, and then you say out state. Okay. And we get this block sphere. Okay. And one second. So this is the first qubit, this is the second qubit, and it is not clear what it's showing. Okay. Well, let me perform some more manipulations, okay, and then we'll get something clear. All right. So we can get the block representation of both the qubits also. Now, what we want to study is this phenomenon called phase kickback. All right. So this is a very common utility which is employed in quantum computing. One of the reasons is the following, that when you look at actual devices, right? Those devices, like IBM's has a device, what's it called? I forget the code name. Anyway, so those devices, there are some physical restrictions. So for instance, you might have a 5-qubit device, okay? But in a circuit, right? For instance, this quirk circuit, right? I can make any number of wires, and I can connect any wire to any wire. I can make a multi-qubit gate, any multi-qubit gate I like. But in the actual physical implementation, there are restrictions because of, you know, hardware limitations. So for instance, in the 5-qubit machine, it might be possible only to couple the first and second qubits, the third and fourth qubits, right? And the fourth and fifth qubit. So that means you cannot act on the first and fifth qubit, right? If you want to put a C naught between the first and fifth qubit, you cannot do that directly. So what you need to do is you need to be able to take that unitary operator, which acts on the first and fifth qubit, and decompose it into a sequence of operations, which correspond to those which are actually possible on the hardware, right? And that process is called transpiling, which is a concatenation of transformation and compilation, transpiling, okay? So this transpiling process, it uses all of these identities. And for instance, another limitation in the hardware is that typically the only 2-qubit gate that one can apply is the C0 gate, okay? And there are no 3-qubit gates at the hardware level. So for instance, if you want to implement a 3-qubit gate, such as the Toffoli gate, okay? The Toffoli gate is a CC not gate, control not. So what is the Toffoli gate? I can actually draw it here. This is a Toffoli gate. It's a control not. So if you want to implement a gate like this in your quantum hardware, right, you have to have a decomposition of this Toffoli gate in terms of a sequence of single qubit operations and C naught gates, right? So we need to understand how such operations work. And another restriction is that in the hardware, it might not be possible to use if you have, say, qubit 1 and 2. It might not be possible to use qubit 2 as a control qubit, right? So you want to act with a C0 gate on these two qubits, right? But you remember that in one of the protocols, when I was building the swap state, the swap gate. The swap gate involves something like a C0 followed by an inverse C0, then another C0, right? That's a swap gate. So if I want to draw that in Quirk, what does a swap gate look like? You have a C0, then you have a second C0, and a third C0, right? And so what this does is it takes these two states and it swaps them. And once again, if you want to see the swap operation work in real time, you can put this visualization over here, right? And make more both of these states, for instance. Oops. What am I doing? One second. Yeah, okay. And make both of these gates time dependent. And we put a block over here and a block over there. And we put this in a plus state and we can put this in a minus state, right? And so we want to see that the swap operation is happening. Now you can look at these two block spheres and you can see that the block sphere from the first qubit is going into the block sphere of the second qubit and vice versa, right? You can see that visually. So this is a swap gate. And there is a swap gate. There is a single gate for that here also. Where is it? I'm not sure exactly where it is. It's one of these. Okay. So in the quantum hardware, what happens is that you might only be able to make this C0 gate, but not the second one. Okay. So you cannot use the second qubit as a control qubit in the actual physical hardware. Right. So what do? There you have to use this technique called phase kickback. Okay. So what is this phase kickback? So here I have a circuit which has generated a Bell state. Okay. And now let's just say that instead of putting a Hadamard only on the first qubit, I put a Hadamard on the second qubit also. Okay. So I again have a 2x2 circuit. And now I put a Hadamard on both of the qubits. Okay. So I draw this, I get Hadamard, and then C0. And then there is a different drawing backend also, which gives you slightly more pretty pictures. Now we can go through the same procedure, get the simulator backend, save wave vector, assemble it, run it, get the output state, and print it out as an array. Okay. So what is this Hadamard composition do, right? The first Hadamard gives you 0 plus 1. The second Hadamard gives you 0 plus 1. So what is the state of the system after the two Hadamards are applied? It's 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1. It's an equal weight superposition of all four basis vectors, right? And what will happen when I act with a C0 on this? The C0 will not affect, there are two states 0 0 and 0 1, which will not be affected by C0. And there are two other states, 1 0 and 1 1. What will C0 do to those? It will simply swap them, right? But since they are in an equal weight superposition, swapping them will leave your state unchanged, right? So what will this C not do? It will not do anything to this state. It will leave it invariant. Okay. And now we can see here, right, that so our output state qubit zero is pointing along this x, right, and the qubit one is along the x. What does this mean? This means that the zero qubit is in the zero plus one state, the first qubit, and the second qubit is in the zero plus one state. Okay, so this tells us that the whole state is factorizable. Okay. Now we'll do something a little bit different. We'll take our second qubit and we'll give it a negative phase. Okay. So what does that do? Let's first look at what's going on. So we put a Hadamard on the first qubit. Okay. Then we put a NOT gate, right? The X gate on the second qubit. And then we put a Hadamard on the first qubit. Okay. And then we say circ dot draw. Okay, so now you can see this looks the same as what we had earlier, and I'll just take this. You have two Hadamards, right? Now I have two Hadamards, but before that, what I have done is I've applied this operation, this X gate. Okay. What does the X gate do? X gate takes your zero input state, right, and converts it to one. Again, if you want to visualize this on the go, you can use Quirk, right? So we clear this circuit. We start in our 0-0 state. Put a Hadamard here. We put an X gate on the second qubit and a Hadamard here. All right, now we can see if I remove this X gate, my second qubit is also in a 0+1, right? But if I put an X gate, what happens? It becomes 0-1, right? So I put a negative phase on the second qubit. All right, so the state that is created after I act on my initial two qubits, right? So I start with this as my basis state. What do I end up with? I end up with, and yeah, there's a 1/2 and 0-0, 0-1. Get 1-0 minus get 1-1 and dollar sign. Oops, so the 1/2 is not defined. I'll just put 0.5. Okay, it's the same thing. So the difference between this circuit and just putting two Hadamards is that I get a negative sign here in this 1-1. Actually, there's a negative sign in this state also. Okay, and so this can be written as ket minus plus. What is the meaning of ket minus plus? That is a product state. So ket minus plus is equal to ket minus tensor ket plus. Okay, And what is get minus? Again, it's root 2 get 0 minus get 1. Right? And then again, root 2 get 0 plus get 1. Right? So this minus plus state is this negative state 0 minus 1 tensor with the positive state 0 plus 1. Okay? Right? Now we can again apply this block visualization to see what it gives us. Right? Oh, right. I didn't go through that whole procedure first. Let me do that. So this is the great thing about this QIS kit, by the way. Sorry, Jupyter. Is that I can merge cells. I have all kinds of shortcuts. I can merge cells. I can cut them, and I can paste them here, right? Right, so you see that what has happened is that X gate has just put a negative phase on the second qubit. Okay. Now what will happen when C naught acts on this state, on this minus plus state, right? What will C naught do? These two states will not be affected by. One second, be very careful. 0, 1. Okay. All right. So now, and once again, let's take this circuit and put a C naught gate, and let's actually see what we get as an answer, right? So when in doubt, calculate. So we say circ dot CX, right? And then control qubit is the first one, and the target qubit is the second one. So let's just make sure that we have the right circuit. Okay, there we go. Hadamard, X Hadamard, and then this one. Okay, great. Once again, we go through the procedure. Oops, I guess I have to probably do something like this. No. Duplicate key, save state vector. What do I do? Circ dot. State vector. One second, just let me quickly see. Okay, let me just comment this. No, it will not work. Okay, so I would have to do the whole procedure again. Let me do that. It's not a big deal. We can copy this here. And paste. Okay. So let's do this again. Okay. Great. And now we'll again use QVis array to latex out state. Okay. All right. Yeah. So what does this state correspond to? This state corresponds to taking this fellow here, right? And now this one has become minus. And so actually better to show you explicitly. So we start with this state. And then when we apply our C naught, we get a minus negative phase, right? So we see that the negative sign has shifted from the last basis vector to the first basis vector, okay? And now this is very interesting, because what it is doing is that, see, initially this was the control qubit and this was the target qubit, right? When we first looked at our circuit, which makes the bell state, right? When we didn't have this second Hadamard gate, this was the control qubit and this was the target qubit. But now, when I put the second Hadamard gate, what does it do? It turns my target qubit into a control qubit and my control qubit into a target qubit. Right? So the net effect of having two Hadamard gates before my C naught, right, is to change the C naught, the orientation of the C naught, right? And so this is called phase kickback. Okay, because I inserted a phase over here, this X component. I inserted a phase here in the X component, right? And what is happening is that this phase is being kicked back to the first qubit, right? So this is 0, 1, you get a negative sign here, right? So this is phase kickback. Okay, because what you expected was that the net result of this should be that your control qubit should remain unchanged, right? Your target qubit should change. That is what a C naught gate should do. But when I put this two Hadamards, something interesting happens. The control qubit becomes a target and the target becomes a control. Okay. And so what is the, let's look at this thing. Multi-vector representation of this output state. Okay, so this is the multi-vector representation, right? Now, what is this? Can somebody tell me in terms of the plus and minus states, what is the full state of the system? So we started out with this state, which is minus plus. We end up with this state. What is this state? Can somebody look at it and tell me what it is? Or from this picture, can you read off? What is this state? This arrow along the negative x-axis, which state does this represent?
I?
No, this is minus. This is the minus state. Yes. This is the plus state. This is the minus state. This would be I. This would be minus I. I is along the y-axis. Okay? So what is happening here is that you are going from the minus plus. Yeah, sorry, Shantanu.
Minus plus to minus minus.
It goes to minus one. Right? So it's minus minus.
But sir, I want to ask something.
Yeah, go ahead.
Like we have typed out that is zero minus one, zero minus one state. Is there a way like I can see it, like not from the block diagram, but from this only that my output is that?
Well, you can look at this array, no?
Okay, so.
So this output state, right? When you say this get state vector. So see, it depends on which simulator you use. Like I said, there are different backends. Okay, there are all these different backends. There's an air simulator, right? There is a unitary simulator, state vector, all of these, they all have different properties. For instance, if I use a unitary simulator, okay, what it will give me is it will give me the unitary matrix corresponding to the full circuit. Okay. So for instance, if I want to write down the unitary matrix corresponding to this circuit, what will be the unitary matrix? Can somebody tell me what will be the unitary matrix corresponding to H on the first qubit and X on the second qubit? How would I write that? I would write it as H O times X, right? This is how I would write HX, right? Yes, no.
Yes,
right? This is the tensor product. So this is the first matrix. Then what is happening in the second step? How would I write this second step? That somebody should tell me. The second step where the H matrix only acts on the second qubit, how do I write that as an operator? What happens on the first qubit?
One O times H.
Exactly, right? One O times H. And then the last one is the C naught. Right? So this is the sequence of operations. Now each one of these is a 4x4 matrix, right? This is a 4x4 matrix, this is a 4x4 matrix, this is a 4x4 matrix. When I multiply all of them, I get a 4x4 unitary matrix corresponding to the full circuit. Okay? So you have to choose, depending on which backend you choose, you get different representations. Okay? There is another backend, for instance, you will see here, there's something called a density matrix. Now we haven't talked about what density matrices are, we will talk about them later. Okay, and then there's something called a super operator, matrix product state. These are all different representations of quantum states. Okay, so what we are doing is we are looking at the output state with using the state vector simulator, right? And so again, if I just want to look at the components, I say array to LaTeX, right? And then my out state, and you see it gives me the components 1 minus 1 minus 1 1, right? And that corresponds to this. That corresponds to this state here, right? Of course, it would be nice if it gave me a beautifully formatted thing in terms of this ket notation. I'm sure they will add that in another addition of QI state, or one of you could write some code which implements that functionality. Okay. Now to wrap up, finally, let me just quickly show you what the final circuit identity is going to be, which is the following. So we start with, once again, this thing, we start with a reverse C0. And then we say circ.h0, circ.h1, circ.cx, controlled x, 0, 1. And then, right, how do we go from the minus state back to the zero state? We apply another hardamard. Right, so we say circ.h1 and circ.h0 again, and then we draw this. Right, this is our identity. Okay, now once again, we can go through that whole procedure, which was this set of commands here. Okay, and then we say qvis dot array to latex, array to latex out state. Again, I don't know why I'm getting these extra keys. Out state, right? And what does this do? It just brings us back to the 0, 0 state. Right, you can see this is the 0, 0 state, right? And this corresponds to, if I take another quantum circuit, is equal to quantum circuit 2, and then I say circ2.cx, but now I say 1, 0. And then circ2.draw, right? So this is an inverse C0. So the claim is that this circuit is equivalent to the inverse C0. So if you want to overcome this hardware limitation, which only permits you to use C0 gates acting in one direction, what do? You use this phase kickback effect, right? To turn the target qubit into a control qubit and vice versa. Okay. Now let me just tell you one thing. Okay. All of this is taken straight from the QIS kit textbook. All right. So the only thing I'm doing, right? Well, I'm not the only thing, it's not something completely trivial. I'm taking some content from Nielsen and Chuang. I'm taking some content from Thomas Wong's book. And I'm taking some content from QIS kit textbook, right? And I'm putting this together in some order, which I think will make, you can tell some sort of a story, right? So for instance, if you work through the QIS kit textbook, if you work through the QIS kit textbook, right, you will go through quantum states, single qubits, then multiple qubits, then entanglement, then phase kickback, proving universality. You will go through all of these steps, then quantum algorithms, all of these algorithms, and then you would come to quantum teleportation and superdense coding and so on. Right? Now, if you are an individual who has limited amounts of time on their hands, going through all of these, right, may seem like a daunting task, right? So hopefully, you know, what I've been trying to do in this course is to map out a path which familiarizes you with the various aspects of quantum computing. All right. Circuits, measurements, algorithms, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, in the next coming classes, there are some. What I plan to do is I plan to cover these different algorithms. Okay. So I'll start with something called this Deutsch-Chorza algorithm, based on Simon's algorithm. But in the meantime, I want you to work through these quantum computing labs. Okay, so this is your exercise. You have to make Jupyter notebooks. Okay, or you can do it in Google Colab. And you have to work through this lab one. Okay, quantum circuits. And what is done in this lab is they implement classical logical gates with quantum circuits. Right. So what are classical logic gates like XOR, AND, NAND, and OR, right? And these are implemented using the CNOT gate and the Toffoli gate. Okay. So what I want you to do is to make your own notebooks. Of course, the code is all there. All you have to do is click on this try button and it will do the job for you. Right. If you want, it's your choice to do just that much, right? But the goal is to get you to actually work through this code and understand how it works and learn how to use these various tools. Okay, so this will be your exercise, and I will ask you to submit this in the form of either a Jupyter notebook or a Colab notebook on Moodle, okay? And this will be due 1 week from now. So this is your homework, and I will stop here for the day. Okay. And by the way, this is the attendance. This is how I'm taking attendance on. So just in case somebody is curious. All right. Okay. Well, that's it for today. Any questions? Questions?
So we have to do all the labs in one notebook or a separate notebook for each lab?
No, I want you to do lab one. Okay. Lab one. Right. So, I mean, yeah, it would be better if you like kept things separate.
But for submission, it's only one then.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So if you have any questions, then I am here to answer them. No? Okay, then bye, and I'll see you all on Wednesday. Okay, and we have to have a quiz or something. I don't know what I'll do about that. We'll see. Okay, so unless you have questions, you are all free to go. Questions, no questions. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, can you open Quirk?
Yeah, sure. 1 second. Okay.
Sir, how to add a third qubit? It is a 00 already present.
Third qubit, you just drag a gate down here, for instance, okay? Like this. It will automatically put a wire there.
Okay. Right. I try, but it
huh?
doesn't I tried, but doesn't come.
Like you just see, put this here. Right, so this is a swap gate. It automatically adds the qubit as you need more.
Okay. Yes.
Any other questions? No. All right, then I'll stop the recording.